The trailers and TV spots for Immortals heavily tout the fact that it comes to us
from the producers of 300.
Most of the time, the producer credit promotion is the last-ditch effort of a marketing campaign that's realized it has literally nothing else to sell its product on, but in this case, it's just being honest. Not only does it come from the same team who shepherded that particular surprise box office mega-hit to the big screen, it's also a nakedly obvious attempt at making that lightning strike twice with yet another highly stylized ancient Greek action epic. Save that while 300 came from a collaboration between proficient visual stylist Zack Snyder and cranky has-been Frank Miller, Immortals is a singular vision, courtesy of the eclectic film and video director professionally known as Tarsem, late of The Cell, The Fall, and that one Pepsi commercial with the Gladiatrixes. As a filmmaker, Tarsem is best known for his endlessly unique stylistic sensibilities, and Immortals is a film that is all about style. There's absolutely no pretense toward realism, physical reality, or even narrative plausibility. It's a film that wants you to know it's a film, with costumes, sets, makeups, and exquisitely detailed money shots all constantly screaming, "Look at us!" while the lovingly composed cinematography screams, "Look at them!" The style is the substance, with the story and characters existing strictly as an excuse for the filmmakers to assemble a gigantic moving Renaissance-style mythology painting. Narratively, it's the very height of basic. You'll recall from Greek mythology that the better-known Olympian gods were supposed to have defeated and imprisoned a previous collection of monster gods called Titans. Mickey Rourke's evil king Hyperion wants to overthrow the Olympians by releasing the Titans, but can only do so by finding a magic bow. Said bow is also sought by future Superman Henry Cavill as the hero Theseus, who has a personal score to settle with Hyperion and has been secretly trained for the mission by Zeus, as the gods are forbidden from interfering with human wars because the movie would be over too quickly if they did. Unfortunately, while the plotting is stylistically simple, structure-wise, it's very traditional. Which means that in between the opulent insanity of the first and second acts, there's a long stretch of Act 2 wherein the film makes the mistake of assuming that we're going to care about the feelings and motivations of a cast of exquisitely costumed action figures. Oh, it's tolerable, mostly because it's interesting to watch Tarsem's heightened mythology aesthetic crash up against what sometimes looks like a sincere attempt to present ancient Greece as it actually might have looked, and because the cast are all pretty game for it, but it does end up serving as a reminder that the point of using broad archetypal characters is that you don't have to slow down the movie to develop them. Still, though it takes a little while to really get going, once it gets there, holy shit. You know, from the trailers, you might have assumed that this was some PG-13 Clash of the Titans thing. No, it is not. For all its avant-garde pretense, Immortals is easily the most brutally yet joyfully violent movie I've seen all year. We're not just talking blood, we're talking severed limbs, decapitations, people split in half, guts and entrails flying everywhere, and I'm not even sure I can describe the stuff Mickey Rourke's guys do to people. And that's just the humans. When the gods and titans fight, it looks like a multiplayer Mortal Kombat, except every hit is a fatality, and everyone is playing as Scarlet. For all the coattail riding, when Immortals hits its stride, it makes 300 look more like 3%. You know, actually, to hell with the rebirth guy, this dude should be directing the new Mortal Kombat movie. What's kind of amazing and very depressing is that more films and filmmakers don't try what Tarsem is aiming for with Immortals, essentially a kind of arthouse action movie. The blockbuster action genre, with its simple story demands, archetypal hero-villain setups, and emphasis on sensory stimulation, would seem the perfect framework from which to cut loose with visual experimentation or real narrative daring, yet so many simply fall back on the same boring, tedious macho touchstones. One endless montage of munitions, engines, camo, choppers, squealing tires, and tribal tats after another. Even 300, for all its visual panache, couldn't quite escape its grounding in Frank Miller's childish xenophobia and obnoxious militaristic wanking. Immortals, on the other hand, is as far removed from all that twaddle as you can get. Amid all the hacking, slashing, blood splattering is a repertoire of iconography culled from world mythology, classical art, rococo architecture, and even modern high fashion. Right down to the way its model pretty gods and fetishistically costumed mortals and monsters go all in on the inherent eroticism of action films in general and Greek mythology in particular that most films in the genre approach with the trepidation of an insecure 13-year-old. I don't know that I can call Immortals a complete success. It's got structural problems that no amount of visual pizzazz can excuse, including the way that Stephen Dorff's character seems to vanish throughout the movie, and too many side bits and other characters feel whittled down to nothingness in search of a tighter edit. But given that the main point seems to have been letting a visionary filmmaker ply his trade in service of a crowd-pleasing gonzo action flick, I can't say it doesn't kill where the killing counts. Is it just more sound and fury looking to serve as momentarily distracting eye candy? Yes, but it's a completely different looking and feeling sound and fury. Sometimes, that's enough. See you next time.